أفلا يتدبرون القرآن
ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهديه الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم The Quran, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us how to be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the right way, the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us, and how to be obedient to Him. The Quran sets for us and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam what things for us to do, what things we are forbidden from doing, to conduct our life in the most perfect way with matters of belief and ibadah and halal and haram and so on. But all of this, all of the actions of the human beings, if it's not based on the clear foundation of the Tawheed and the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His Lordship, in His worship, in His names and attributes, then the actions becomes very weak and not very strong and well established. And this is our job and our duty, is to establish our foundations very strong, to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His names and attributes, to worship Him alone so that we can enjoy and really enjoy the acts of obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These verses, inshallah ta'ala, that we will discuss, inshallah ta'ala, in this episode in Surat An-Nisaa, from 131 to 135, talks about some of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is strongly related to the taqwa, to the fear of Allah, to be obedient to Allah. In Surat An-Nisaa, where it many orders from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the surah regarding relationships, and for people to take care of their wives and their children and so on and so forth. And within, in the midst of all of these verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding the believers of some of His attributes for all of these actions to be done with that perspective, with sincerity, with the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, without arrogance, without feeling that we are doing something great, that we deserve certain things as a result of that, but instead to feel that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the ever rich subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is in no need of our ibadah, our actions, our deeds. We are the ones are in need of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let's reflect upon these verses from 131 to 135 in Surah An-Nisaa. The first one, so verse number 131, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَقَدْ وَصَّيْنَا الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ وَإِيَّاكُمْ أَنِ اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَإِنْ تَكْفُرُوا فَإِنَّ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَنِيًّا حَمِيدًا. Which means, and to Allah belongs whatever in the heavens and whatever is on the earth. And we have instructed those who were given the scripture before you and yourselves to fear Allah. But if you disbelieve, then to Allah belongs whatever is in the heavens and whatever is on the earth, and ever is Allah free of need and praiseworthy. So the ayah starts with walillah, and to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ma fi samawati wa ma fi al-ard, what's on the heavens, what's in the heavens and what's in the earth. And we know that many verses in the Quran starts with lillah or walillah, which means to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the significance of the verses starting with the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that everything belongs to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, belongs what's in the heavens and the earth, to make the hearts attached to the fact that everything belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in an exclusive way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of all things. He's the creator of all things. Other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His attributes are creation of Allah. Creation means that they have been created by Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created everything. And when we reflect upon this meaning, without just saying it with our tongues, but we need to make it established in our hearts, that we are creation of Allah. Allah created us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created everything. That means He's the one that knows us best. And He is in no need of us. He's the one that made us from nothing. And He's the one that created the heavens and the earth. So He is in no need of ourselves or anything else. But instead, we are in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, since He's the one that bestowed this life by itself to us. So we are in need of Him. So this is a great meaning. If the heart is full and immersed in these beautiful meanings, then you would see that the acts of worship are the easiest things. So وَلِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ, anything that is present in the heavens, وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ, and what's on the earth, whether it's a living thing or non-living thing, anything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created in the heavens and the earth, it all belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَقَدْ وَصَّيْنَا الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابِ. Then as a result of this, this is a matter of belief. So once this belief is established in the heart, then the implication of this then comes after that. وَلَقَدْ وَصَّيْنَا الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ وَإِيَّاكُمْ أَنِ اتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. That we had وَصَّيْنَا, we had instructed. And الْوَصِيَّة is to instruct someone of something that is so important that you might not see that person afterwards. This is from a human being to a human being. Like the wasiyah, like the will for a person before he dies. So it's usually exclusive and very detailed and well explained. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the ever living. He instructed the people, those who received the books before us, before the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And every prophet was sent, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed them clearly without any ambiguity whatsoever. And this is by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those who received the book, min qablikum, before you, wa iyyakum, and yourselves, meaning this ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to do what? An ittaqullah, that you would ittaqullah, to have the taqwa of Allah. The translation they say, to fear Allah. This is one of the meanings of the taqwa, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed those who before us and instructed us in the Quran and in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which means to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to purify ourselves constantly from sins, and to constantly repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these are the three meanings of a taqwa as it's explained in the Quran. A taqwa of Allah, to fear Allah, to shield yourself from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is basically to apply the entire religion of Al-Islam. It's to do the good deeds with the proper knowledge from the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and to stay away from evil deeds according to the Quran and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of the fear that we will be punished if we transgress the limits. And all of that is with the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the word ittaqu or taqwa means that you shield yourself, you protect yourself. So ittaqullah, to shield yourself from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is, as we heard before many times, this is the goal, this is the objective of the ibadah, for the believers to have this level of taqwa, to fear Allah, to be dutiful to Allah, to be watchful of everything that they do, and to see the outcome of it. This came in the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمُ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. O mankind, worship your Lord, the one that created you and the one that created those who before you, so that لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, so that you would have the taqwa, the fear of Allah, to be dutiful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to constantly purify yourself from sins, and the goals of the ibadah in general. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showing us that this is the wasiyah, this is the advice, this is the instruction to be given. That's why many of the people of knowledge, whenever someone would come and ask them for an advice, to advise them, to give them some instructions, they would start with the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed all mankind. وَلَقَدْ وَصَّيْنَا الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ وَإِيَّاكُمْ أَنِ اتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. If someone asks you for advice, if you would say to that person to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you had fulfilled that duty. And then to go to the details of that, it's all based on what the taqwa is. So if you advise someone to have the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you advise them with whatever specific need that he is in need of, it's all based on the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If a person wants to start a business, for example, and he's seeking your advice because you have an experience, you can jump into the subject immediately and tell him what to do and how to deal with his money and his partners and the market and so on and so forth. But if there's no taqwa of Allah, if there's no fear of Allah, if the person is not being dutiful to Allah, what is the benefit of all of this? He would drag himself into the hellfire. And this is not really a sincere advice. So the sincere advice has to be with the foundation of the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why if you want to ask for an advice from someone in whatever means of expertise, whether it's of course religious matters, we ask the people of knowledge. Worldly matters, it doesn't mean that we just go to the experts and that's it. A person has to have righteousness in him. If you ask someone that is an expert in something, but he doesn't have the righteousness, he does not have the taqwa, he might lead you astray. He might lead you to do things that is not permissible. He would adorn the evil to you. And that's why the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the foundation. Once we have this foundation, then things after that becomes beautified. Otherwise, it is of no value whatsoever. So, anit taqullah, to fear Allah, to be dutiful to Allah. And then after that, it shows also the implication of the fact that you believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belongs to Him all what's in the heavens and what's in the earth. وَإِن تَكْفُرُوا فَإِنَّ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. If you disbelief, if you turn away from this, if you deny the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you disbelieve in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do not have the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to Him belongs what's in the heavens and what's in the earth. It's repeated again to remind the reciter of the Quran, to remind the believers, to remind all mankind that your obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you would not benefit Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by your taqwa, by your obedience. You are the one in need of it. Otherwise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in no need of it whatsoever. So if all human beings, they all disbelief and they all oppose the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, would they decrease or take any way from the treasures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in no need of them. Would they harm Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Of course not. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of all things. So really the benefit is for those who are obedient to Allah. And again, this is the implication, this is the outcome of such a proper belief, that if a person believes truly that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belongs to him everything in the heavens and the earth, then they should fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. They should be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. They should be so eager to know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from them, so that they're obedient to him. And they should fear, the most that they fear is the kufr, disbelief, and associating partners with Allah. And to see with their own hearts clearly that human beings do not benefit Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are harming themselves when they turn away from the truth. وَإِن تَكْفُرُوا. If you disbelieve, فَإِنَّ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belong what's in heavens and what's in the earth. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in more than one place in the Quran. وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوا يَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَكُونُوا أَمْثَالَكُمْ. For example, if you turn away from the deen of Allah, if you turn away from giving the victory to the deen of Allah, applying the deen of Allah in your life and advising others and calling others and so on, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will replace you by others, as it will come in the next verse, and they won't be the like of you. You are not the one that is benefiting the deen, benefiting the religion. The religion is victorious at all times. The religion is victorious, is superior, because it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The honor and the dignity and the goodness and so on is for the one that is sincerely doing things for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِن تَكْفُرُوا فَإِنَّ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. It's repeated because we are in need of this repetition. Our hearts need these meanings and these attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us to be reminded of it all the time, even in the same verse. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَنِيًّا حَمِيدًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala indeed is ever rich, and He is the one that is praiseworthy. غَنِيًّا, two names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are mentioned in this verse. غَنِيًّا حَمِيدًا. What's the significance of them? What does it mean? How is it related to the verse and what comes afterwards? Inshallah ta'ala, we'll discuss that right after the break, so stay with us inshallah.
Muhammad, the most common name in the world. Why were so many parents interested and still are interested in naming the children Muhammad? What are examples of his love, his compassion, his mercy, his dedication, his sincerity, his bravery? How did he balance between private life and the public sphere of life? Why is he known as the greatest mercy sent to humankind? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, join us as we learn more about the balanced and beautiful personality of perfection, Muhammad.
والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We're still in verse number 131 from Surat An-Nisaa, and towards the end of the verse, two names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are mentioned. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَنِيًّا حَمِيدًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is غني. غني means ever rich. He is the one that is in no need of anyone, free of all needs, and he is the one that is praiseworthy. Two names with attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Ghani means literally the one that is rich. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Ghani, the ever rich. The one that he is the most rich, that nothing is the like of him subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we think of something or someone that is rich, you know, you would think someone that has a lot of wealth, a lot of power, human beings. That's an individual. That individual dies, he gets sick, he's not that strong, he's not that rich, because there are also other wealth present on the face of earth. Imagine someone on the face of earth has all the richness of the earth and whatever it contains, all belongs to him. He's still a creation of Allah. How powerful that person would be, something that is we cannot even imagine. But he's still a creation of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to him belong what's in the heavens and what's in the earth. So there's no one really have the true meaning of being rich. When we talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's the most rich. Not the most rich compared to others. Richness itself belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any human being that owns anything, it's not really his in the absolute sense, because it all belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Life itself belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So all of the wealth and all the human beings and all the treasures and the gold and the silver and whatever there is, and life itself and the heavens and the earth, all belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the owner of all things. So there is no really rich except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the most rich, he's the ever rich. He's the one that is in no need of anyone. And that's why when a person is rich, he depend less on human beings and people depend on him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most rich, and he's the one that is in no need of all of the human beings and all that exist. But at the same time, he is Hamidan. Hamidan meaning he's the one that deserves the praiseworthy. He's the praiseworthy. The one that Alhamd, the perfect praise to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Perfect praise. If all human beings, they get together to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they would keep on praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the best language and the most eloquent speech that they have from their hearts and their tongues, and if they do that forever, they would never be able to fulfill the real praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the most perfect way, because he's the one that is praiseworthy. And that's why out of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are taught Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, this is a great word that fills the heavens and the earth, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said. Why? Because within Alhamdulillah, when you say it, it means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the perfect praise, the perfect names and attributes. There is nothing the like of it whatsoever. So he is Hamidan. He is the one that is praiseworthy subhanahu wa ta'ala with the perfect names and attributes. And he is at the same time Ghani. That means he is the ever rich. Nothing is the like of him. When these two names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are together, brings another beautiful meaning. When they're one is alone, each one has a great and perfect meanings. And when they're both together, it shows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in no need of your actions, in no need of you whatsoever. But at the same time, he's Hamid. He is all praiseworthy. That means he treats his slaves with his mercy, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he rewards them, that he guides them, that he provides for them in this life, and he makes them enter Jannah when he is in no need of them, because he is Al-Hamid, subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that is praiseworthy, the one that people need to praise him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he's the one that deserves that praise. So these types of meanings brings in the hearts of the believers the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It basically gives another perspective of why we need to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not by qahr or force or oppression, right? It's by the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course. But the believers, their hearts, because of the love of Allah, because of these great meanings, they turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in obedience, because this is the only way. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from them, and He is in no need of them whatsoever. They don't play tricks, they don't deceive themselves, unlike the hypocrites, as the verses in the next episode inshallah ta'ala will talk about the hypocrites. The hypocrites, they think that they can deceive Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the dominion of the heavens and the earth belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For the believers, they find themselves, their submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very easy, in matters of ease. Of course, there is our own desires and the shayateen and so on, but with the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the believers' hearts are settled, in state of tranquility, in state of comfort. And the jewel of their eyes is when they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He is Al-Ghani and He is Al-Hamid subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then again, the next verse repeated again the same meaning for these matters of belief to be established in the hearts, to see how the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be something very beautiful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the next verse, 132, وَلِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ وَكِيلًا, which means to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belongs whatever is in the heavens and whatever is on the earth, and sufficient is Allah as disposer of affairs. So the statement is repeated again, وَلِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Sometimes when you read a book, even in the tafsir of the verses of the Quran, you would find sometimes the ulama would say, and the tafsir of this ayah has been mentioned in previous surah or previous verse, right? So refer to the tafsir in the previous verse. Or you read something and you read it again, so you would refer people to the previous explanation that you had. But we have to be careful that when the Quran, the verses or words of the verses are repeated, it's repeated for a reason. And that's why we should not skip it. For example, a person might recite the Quran, he says, I just recited the like of this. So he would skip the verse. No, this is of course definitely not permissible. And the person has to recite, not just to recite the verse, but our hearts are in need of these verses. And for the hearts to be purified with these verses, one verse after another. So we are in need for this repetition of the verse. Like for example, in Surah Ar-Rahman, فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ, verse that is repeated so many times throughout the surah. Many people ask, why is it repeated? We are in need of this repetition. We need to react to this repetition of the verse. We need to reflect upon the verses and bring back to it every each verse the meaning of فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. And the same thing here, it was mentioned first, وَلِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ, establishing the aqeedah, establishing the belief in the heart that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belonged to Him what's in the heavens and the earth. And then after that, when the verse talked about the fear of Allah and the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then warning if people disobey Him, reminding them that to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belong the heavens and the earth, what's in the heavens and the earth, to bring these names and attributes in the hearts for the believers to have another perspective of the obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then it's repeated again, وَلِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ وَكِيلًا. If the hearts become attached to other than Allah, when a person is obedient to Allah, he would face all kinds of trials and afflictions and opposition from human beings and so on. So the believers, they are in need of this reminder again, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sufficient for the believers, and He is the disposer of affairs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sufficient and disposer of affairs. وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ وَكِيلًا. كَفَى means it's sufficient, it is enough. The believers, they do not need anyone besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is sufficient, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sufficient as a wakil, as a disposer of affairs. The ones that would really guide the believers to do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from them, and He disposed their affairs, and He's the one that guides them, and He's the one that provides for them, and He's the one that would have the control of the heavens and the earth. All of the people in the heavens and all the people on the earth are the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are under the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you're obedient to Allah, And the shayateen of the mankind and jinn would whisper to you that people would harm you, that people won't like you. Remember, وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ وَكِيلًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sufficient as disposer of our affairs. He's the one that we rely on. He's the one that would make our deeds blessed and accepted and would have great benefit of it in this life and in the hereafter. Why? Because He subhanahu wa ta'ala belongs to Him what's in the heavens and the earth. So the tawheed first, the tawheed when we're doing the acts of worship, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before we act, when we're doing the acts of worship, after we do the acts of worship, the hearts needs to be attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at all times, and to renew our faith and renew our belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala constantly, and to rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all of our affairs, in our relationships, in the subject of what Surat An-Nisaa is about, in our relationships, in all of our affairs, we rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the true people, the true ones that truly rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those are the ones that have the taqwa of Allah. So for someone to say, I rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that I trust and I believe and rely on Him, that would not work unless you have the taqwa of Allah, to have the obedience of Allah, to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise a person is contradicting himself. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after stating these facts, then in verse 133, إِن يَشَأْ يُذْهِبُكُمْ أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ وَيَأْتِ بِآخَرِينَ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلَى ذَٰلِكَ قَدِيرًا. Which means, if He wills, He can do away with you, O people, and bring others in your place. And ever is Allah competent to do that. إِن يَشَأْ يُذْهِبُكُمْ. Again, the meaning is repeated. This is all is mentioned implicitly when we say to Allah belong what's in the heavens and what's in the earth. Everything belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, and that's why the specifications that are mentioned here is to renew the faith in the heart, to make the matter well established, for the evidence of the tawheed to be well established, for our actions to be accordingly. إِن يَشَأْ, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, the mashia of Allah, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, يُذْهِبُكُمْ أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ. يُذْهِبُكُمْ, which means He would do away with you, He would make you be removed from this earth, He would take you away. That means He would destroy you, He will make you replaced by others. أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ, O mankind, O people. وَيَأْتِ بِآخَرِينَ, and He would bring other people instead of you, because He is the most rich, He is in no need of you. You are the ones that are in need of your actions. If He will subhanahu wa ta'ala, He can replace you by others. So don't think as a human being that you're all that. You're all that if you are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and still the more the person is in state of belief, the more he and she humbles themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We see how things on the face of earth, whenever there's an earthquake or a hurricane or whatever there is, human beings are so weak, they're so helpless. And it doesn't have to be from above them with these mighty powers of the wind and so on. It can be a virus, it can be a bacteria that takes the lives of thousands and millions. Right? How weak are the human beings, and how arrogant they are when they witness their weaknesses. All of that is because of the aql that Allah gave them, because of the intellect and reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them. Their reason, if they really put their reason in place and in work, they would see how much they are in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how much they should humble themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because everything belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and therefore they should rely on Him alone. If He will subhanahu wa ta'ala, He would replace you, meaning the disbelievers, to replace them by the believers, as the ulama they said when the verses of the Quran were revealed, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replaced the disbelievers with the sahaba radiallahu anhum, with the believers. And it's the same warning for those who turn away from their religion. If you don't hold fast to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is not the deen that would be victorious because of you. You would be replaced. And to be replaced, this is a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If someone is honored and trusted to do a great job, people do that even in their workplace. You know, if a father would entrust his son to do something, and he would choose that one son to do something for him, the son would be so proud of himself, and he would do the job in the most perfect way. The same thing if the head of a company, and you're someone that is in the first levels of entry levels in a company, and the head of the big multi corporation and so on, and he would entrust you with something, he would entrust you for you to do something, how honored you would be, and how hope you would have that if you fulfill the job in the right way, that he might elevate you and give you so much praise and so on. And this is people do with one another, human beings to a human being. How about the creator of the heavens and the earth? You know, to have the fear that you're replaced by someone else because you did not fulfill your job, this is one of the punishments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the people on earth. And that's what something that the early generations of Islam, they feared for themselves so much, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would replace them. When we don't give victory to the deen of Allah, when we don't apply the deen of Allah, when we don't enjoin good and forbid evil and give da'wah and call others to this truth, to this beautiful deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then what happens? The replacement can come. And those who replace us can be better than us, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. So that means the honor, all the honor is for those who would work for the sake of Allah and obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَشَأْ يُذْهِبُكُمْ أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ وَيَأْتِي بِأَخَرِينَ. And He bring others. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلَى ذَلِكَ قَدِيرًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is competent to do that. And there's in the Arabic language, there is, it's not exactly as it is in the translation with the orders of the words, because again the meanings of exclusiveness. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioned first. عَلَى ذَلِكَ, on doing so, قَدِيرًا, competent, on doing so, in replacing you. So this is mentioned first, because this is something so easy for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do. Something that if a person realizes it, he would have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is capable of doing so. He can replace you, and replace you by someone else and other generations. And we are replaced by generations to come, our generation. And why would we want our generations to take responsibility and not us? Right? We have to, basically one of our duties being alive on the face of earth is to make sure that the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is being given to the next generation in the most perfect way. That the next generation would receive from us the perfect way of life, which is the deen of Islam. To be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, again, the honor can be taken away from us and to be given to someone else. إِنْ يَشَأْ يُذْهِبُكُمْ أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ وَيَأْتِي بِأَخَرِينَ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلَى ذَلِكَ قَدِيرًا. Great meanings in the hearts for the believers. And then the next verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, which is 134, about the practicality and actions, and to direct the hearts of the human beings and for the believers to really seek what is benefiting for them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ ثَوَابَ الدُّنْيَا فَعِنْدَ اللَّهِ ثَوَابُ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا. Whoever desires the reward of this world, then with Allah is the reward of this world and the hereafter. And ever is Allah hearing and seeing. Again, the same meaning. And this is how beautiful the Quran is. Purifying the hearts. And purifying the hearts one verse after another. If the previous verse, you know, did not do it for us, we have the second one and the third one and so on. مَنْ كَانَ يُرِيدُ ثَوَابَ الدُّنْيَا. Whoever desires and wants the thawab, the reward of this dunya, the reward of this world. What is the reward of this world? To be, whether it's for the materialistic matters, wealth, health, happiness and so on, or even to be guided, to be steadfast on the deen of Allah, because this is the reward of this life, for the person to be obedient to Allah. This is the real reward in this life, to be obedient to Allah, to be steadfast on the deen of Allah, to be content, to enjoy the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the perfect way. Whoever desires the reward of this life, whether it's materialistics or others, فَعِنْدَ اللَّهِ ثَوَابُ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. Then indeed, you need to know, you need to believe that to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the thawab, the reward of this life and the hereafter, and the hereafter. And that brings a very important concept, and this verse we should remember it, and we should reflect upon it many times. People in this life, when they disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why do they disobey Him? Knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belongs to Him what's in the heavens and what's in the earth. But they would disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala thinking, out of their ignorance of course, that they would gain some benefit as a result of that sin. Whether it's wealth, they think it's maybe more healthy, or desire. They would enjoy themselves for moments or for days or whatever by disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As one said, anything that is enjoyable in this life, it's either haram or it makes you unhealthy or something like this. The things that you really enjoy, you would find some restrictions to it. But this is not what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying if we see things in the right perspective. But to elaborate on that more, inshallah ta'ala, right after the break, so stay with us.
Now that we know more about da'wah, what would you say are the characteristics of a da'i?
Sincerity.
Sincerity? Yes?
Good relation with Allah.
Good relation with Allah. Okay.
Patience.
Yes, sir.
Good manners.
Good manners. And there is much more to that. Join us in our program, the Da'wah Workshop, by your brother, Dr. Rayyan Fawzi Arab, so that we could talk more about da'wah exclusively on Huda TV.
Salatu wassalamu ala ashraf al-mursaleen, nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Verse 134 from Surat An-Nisaa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that whoever desire and wants the thawab, the reward of this dunya, of this life, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the reward of this life and the hereafter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa kana Allahu sami'an basira, He is the all-hearer, the all-seer. We were talking about this verse, that when people disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they think that they would do that because it brings them more joy, more desire, more wealth, and so on. This ayah is a reminder for us. The one that made you enjoy the sin, who's the one that created the joy itself? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when a person is obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking the rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that gives the reward in this life and in the hereafter. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade us of something and we enjoy that sin, that joy is not really a joy, it's a punishment in itself. Because if a person does not repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, either Allah would forgive him or he will be punished, and the person would regret it so much, that a person would regret that joy as a result of sin so much, even if he repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful and he's the most forgiver. And it's the same concept when a person would have poison being put in some honey or something that is very sweet. You might enjoy the sweetness of the honey or the good food that you like. For what? For minutes. But then after that it would kill you. So what's the goodness in it? You would not dare to approach that food whatsoever because you know that it's poisonous for you. And you won't be fool enough to say, but it tastes good. No human being with a sound mind would ever say, but it tastes good. Let me eat it and enjoy it for a few minutes and it's okay if I die afterwards. No person with sound mind would ever say that. And this is a fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created in us to make it clear and for the evidences to be established on us, that also the same way when it comes to the hereafter. If we know that the sins, and we got to know that by the wahi revelation from Allah, the sins are not a good thing. Sins would never bring any good whatsoever. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade it for a reason. So when we commit sins, even though we might enjoy the moments and the days and the, you know, the years that we live, thinking that we're enjoying it, which is not really a real joy, but the outcome of it is so severe. So this is one thing that would make the person away from the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also, if you want to have wealth and health and so on, that all belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So seek it in the right way. Do not be forgetful about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't think that the more you are away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more you will have materialistic things in this life, as many people think. No, there's no contradiction. You can be a righteous person, you can be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides for you. And actually this is what even makes sense. So even for those who seek the pleasure of this life, right, who is the one that this life belongs to? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So even though you seek the pleasure of this life, seek it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Do it with the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, فَإِنَّهُ لَا يُنَالُ مَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا بِطَاعَتِهِ, that whatever you seek from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to be obtained by the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's the most perfect way. If a person disobeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, disbelief and so on, and he's given from this life, from the materialistic things of this life, really that person, it means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want good for that person. Because if he wants good for him, he would make him return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the more he's given from this life, the more he become forgetful, the more he become heedless. So this is a bad sign for him, and this is the istidraj, as we mentioned it before. But for someone, and this is what many people, they don't understand. If a person is given wealth and health and so on, and then he got afflicted by something, and he was disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he got afflicted by severe test, and as a result of that he repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, people think that the trial and the test was for him to lose his health and wealth, but this was for a good reason, for him to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, since he didn't do it at times of ease. I remember a person, for example, he was tested with his own daughter that she got very sick, and he was asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for help, and he started reflecting upon his own self. He was working in riba, working in usury, and he realized that maybe because of this, he repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and left this riba and left this usury, and he works in the halal, which is less, but he was so grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that a sign from Allah was sent for him. He was not, instead of want to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he is at ease, but when he was afflicted by a test, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him to repent. We're not saying that we should seek to be tested. We should ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the best in this life and in the hereafter, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us that the believers, they say, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. Oh Allah, give us hasana, goodness in this life and goodness in the hereafter, and shield us and protect us from the hellfire. This is how the believers, they do, and they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if anything happens, we should understand very well that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise, and He is the most high, and there's a great wisdom behind it, and we need to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at times of ease, so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help us at times of difficulties. And there is a moment of difficulty that we all have to face, which is the moment of death. And this moment of death, and we are ordered to remember death frequently, this moment of death is a difficult moment, and because of that we need to be prepared for it. At times of ease, we are at times of ease. If a person is not dead yet, we are at times of ease to do what? To be obedient to Allah, to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to seek everything from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would help us at the time of difficulties, at the last moments of our life, to keep us steadfast on the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the verses beautifully states that everything belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All the good things in this life and in the hereafter belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the believers, they recite this, they see how ignorant and unjust are human beings, when they would justify for themselves to be disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when everything belongs to Him. When people would think that for them to be more successful, that they have to be away from Allah. Look at the world that we live in. Look at what the media is saying. Look at what, you know, people, you know, whether they are rich or poor. The norm becomes that things are away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our duty is to bring back ourselves and others to these great meanings. And most of the people, they believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the creator of the heavens and earth, but they don't stay in sequence with this. They contradict themselves down the line. If they believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belong to Him what's in the heavens and the earth, then see how the verses is taken as one step after other, after another, to make it so clear that you don't fall into contradictions. So as a result of the belief that He's the owner of all things, that means He's the most rich, He's the one that is praiseworthy, He's the one to be obeyed subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's the one that we rely on, and sufficient is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us to rely on, to be warned against being replaced if we do not fulfill the acts of worship and the duties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala entrusted us to do. And for those who wants this dunya or the hereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belong to Him what's in the heavens and the earth. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا. The last two words in the verse with two names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا. And ever is Allah hearing and seeing. سَمِيعًا, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is as-sami', is the all-hearer. And He hears everything subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the creator of everything and He hears everything that He created subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether it's small or big, whether we as human beings can hear it or not. And again, when we reflect upon this and we see how arrogant human beings can be, when we think of hearing, we think that we have the perfect hearing because we have ears and we can hear things. We are actually among the creation of Allah deficient. Other creation of Allah, they have more ability to hear than us. There are things that we're not able to hear. There are things beyond our hearing capacity. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the all-hearer. He hears everything subhanahu wa ta'ala. He hears your dua. He knows what's in your heart. And He is al-basir. He's the all-seer. What we see and what we do not see. What is seen to be seen in this life and what's not able for people to see whatsoever. Something that is so small that people keep on discovering things for them to see things in this life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-basir, the all-seer, with our actions and our deeds and so on. So again, as a result of all of this, this is matters of belief, and related to it very strongly, our actions, our obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the thawab, the reward in this life and in the hereafter, everything belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us have these realities. And that's why we have to be careful, because next time inshallah ta'ala, when we see the next verse, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who believe, it's all related to this. It depends on what we just said. Otherwise we're not truthful with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if we don't apply these verses together. So the foundation is being set, then therefore after that we need to apply what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to do. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us benefit from what we hear and what we listen. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا.
فلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا.
فلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا.
يتدبرون القرآن
ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا.